Welcome to episode one of our new podcast. Really excited to get this kicked off. I'm Dion Almaer.
And I'm Ben Galbraith. We're the directors of developer relations at Palm. You know, we thought it would be a lot of fun for the first episode of our podcast to actually talk to you about sort of why we came to Palm in the first place, and to also, as part of that, present the vision behind what we're all about in the Palm Developer Program.
Yeah, we've got a lot of really cool content that we're going to be coming out with on this podcast series. We're going to show you walkthroughs on how to build applications. There's some really great engineers at Palm that I can't wait to kind of sneak them on camera and start asking questions, doing really cool low-level stuff on V8 and WebKit, and also just a lot of people actually building our core apps, which I think have a lot of really good information out there. And that's one little thing that I think a lot of people don't know about the Palm platform is that our core apps, Mail, Calendar, et cetera, all just build on web technology.
No, that's right. You can actually go on the device and pull these applications to your local system and play with them and hack them and actually use the code in your own Palm applications. In fact, that's like one of the first things that got us really excited about Palm was envisioning this world where if you want to take the calendar application and tweak it to do something custom, you don't have to, you know, rebuild it from scratch or do crazy reverse engineering things. You can just get the code, hack on it, and put it back on the device.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. And so both Ben and I were at Mozilla working on these fun developer tools for the web. We built this thing called Bespin, which was a web-based code editor. And obviously being at Mozilla, it was very much a culture of trying to keep the web open. So what made us come over to Palm, this handset company?
That's a good question. You know, I think like what really motivated us to come here was realizing that we're seeing an explosion of devices now and in the future, and that what we see now with devices is just the beginning. And there's a lot of cool stuff out there right now, from Kindle to mobile phone space is getting more and more stuff, and then we've seen other stuff in the tablet form factor recently that's really exciting. And you know, I know you have this fantasy of having like your eyeglasses be a device.
If I have to wear glasses, then I want them to be superpowered, you know? I'm just not ready for LASIK yet. I'm the last one holding out, you know?
So devices are clearly extraordinary, and it feels like we're living science fiction today, Star Trek or The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, and as a consumer, this is a fantastic story. As a consumer, we have just these amazing devices available to us that just seem almost miraculous. But from a developer's perspective, the happy scenario starts to break down a little bit.
Yeah, it's kind of like a little bit depressing when we're at CES walking around seeing all these amazing devices and experiences and different form factors. And you can pretty much imagine anything you want these days and think, oh, how could I make this a connected device? And then suddenly you sit down and you think, well, if I'm a developer, especially if I'm at a company that's not a technology company, how do I work with all of these different devices? And we've been running into this as we kind of talk to a bunch of our developers and companies trying to get their experiences out there. There's a massive pain point. Like we were talking to this one really large media firm and they were just like, oh my God, we have to support 86 devices for various reasons. And like every week there's a new thing that comes out, a cool new tablet with its own SDK.
Yeah, totally.
How do you actually build apps for all these things?
Windows Mobile 7 was just announced at Mobile World Congress a couple of weeks ago. And I think this highlights the dilemma. Windows Mobile 7 SDK is Silverlight and XNA. And those are both really interesting technologies from a technical perspective, but it adds one more new technology to the mix. That you have to support. And so if you look at the SDKs for all the devices out there, you've got this extraordinary mix from really low-level C++ with some custom libraries, which is what you see in some of the platforms. In other platforms, you see Java and custom libraries with Java, and other platforms have different variants of C, the object-oriented variants of C, and other platforms have other languages. And so if you're an ISV or even an enterprise company trying to create mobile applications and you want to target these different devices for your mobile experience, man, it's a real headache. Yeah, you've got to create all these different versions. And so this sort of confusing status quo existed back last year. And so when Palm came out at CES in 2009 and announced that the web was the platform for their device, that really jazzed us, that really excited us.
Yeah.
Because we thought, man, this really makes sense. as a solution to the fragmentation we're seeing.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are excited about seeing a competitor to the iPhone and this sexy device that does multitasking and stuff. And that was really, really cool. But as soon as they talked about WebOS, it's like, whoa, what do you mean WebOS? Like, what exactly is it? And it's like, it is what it says, right? It's like WebKit is built in right into the device. You pretty much boot right into WebKit and you're right into your web world. And I've played in the mobile world a little bit, and it's always been like this frustrating experience, right? Like, I want to be there because a lot of people are there and you can do interesting things. That's where people are doing things. But man, I didn't want to work in those environments at all. I'm a web guy, and it just never really kind of felt right for me to kind of like really wade in deep. So this was like, oh, finally, it's like the technology that I enjoy. We happen to be at a place in the mobile landscape where you can do amazing things on mobile. Back in the day, like I used to visit the London office at Google, and they'd have just like millions of different devices of feature phones, and like these poor engineers trying to make this stuff work on J2ME.
J2ME with the different profile.
Absolute disaster. And they even Google kind of scrapped that and was just like, we're going to do mobile web versions of this stuff, and the world's going to catch up. And Palm kind of leapfrogged. I'm like, we're going all in and made the biggest bet possible on the web.
Before Chrome OS, at a time when Google's mobile strategy was just Java. Yeah. And for us, you know, when you look at the landscape, if you ask yourself, you know, how can you unify all these mobile devices? What technology stack makes sense? Well, if you look at the web, it turns out it's the most widely deployed platform in history. There's over 1 billion web clients out there, and the number continues to grow. And so, as a consequence, there are more developers that know the web technology stack than any other platform out there. And so we thought, you know, when Paul made this announcement, it made a ton of sense for solving the device fragmentation that we see out there. And as longtime web advocates, of course, we were really thrilled, because at the time that happened, we were asking ourselves, geez, how can we help the web platform succeed as an application platform to solve fragmentation on the desktop and mobile? These are some of the conversations we were having at Mozilla at the time.
Yeah, totally.
And so Palm embraces the web and makes it the first class platform of our device. As Dion mentioned earlier, all of the native applications on the device, the mail application, the calendar application, the phone application, they're all written using HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. They're web apps running on the device. And so this makes it really easy for web developers to actually create applications on Palm. But we've been talking about fragmentation. How does it solve fragmentation? Well, it solves it because if you look at all of these emerging mobile devices, one of the things we're seeing is that they all have really modern web browsers present in the platform. And they're usually based on WebKit. Sometimes they're based on Mobile Firefox in the case of the Nokia MIMO platform. And so this lets us take the web application assets we create and actually deploy them as applications, even on these other platforms too. And so that's something that we find really compelling about the web. So if all you know is the web and you're a desktop developer, geez, Paul makes it easy for you to take your web skills and come to the platform. But if you also want to solve the problem of fragmentation and get your application deployed to as many devices as you can, there are ways you can take that application and take the majority of those assets and code and actually deploy them as native applications to other platforms like iPhone, like BlackBerry and Android and Samsung's new Bada platform and all these emerging smartphone platforms, device platforms. So that's a really cool scenario, I think, that the web enables.
Absolutely. In other episodes, we'll talk about these technologies. We'll bring up PhoneGap and Accelerated Titanium and this whole slew of technology that's kind of coming around to realize that kind of WebKit and Opera and Firefox, to some extent, is kind of in all of these really rich smartphones. And you as a web developer can have a massive reach, sharing a lot of the same assets. And then another thing that I found interesting, like we're web guys, but when we joined Palm, there's this whole Palm OS culture. And I was curious to see kind of like how those guys felt about this stuff. And we went and met some of those developers like Markspace. And what Ben was talking about before with kind of just the ease of use of taking your web skills and building apps, we saw that prove out in this case as one example. So Markspace have a really interesting sync product, and they ported it over to WebOS. They were very early on. And to get this out in time for the launch, to really be ready from day one, they needed extra help, and they got that help from IT, which is pretty rare in my experience that IT actually helps you do
Except
something.
Except at Palm, we love the IT department at Palm.
Very helpful, yeah. But these guys from IT, because they're building websites all day, could kind of come on board, and they were super excited because they went from doing IT stuff to now feeling like they're app developers. And that's really, really exciting.
So that's a little bit about the role that we see the web fulfilling in mobile in general, and the role that it fulfills in Palm. And we think it's the future, and it's really exciting. We also wanted to talk about another key part of the application environment at Palm. This is a piece of technology we announced at CES last month, and it's really pretty cool. The web has always had plugins as a key part of the ecosystem. In fact, if you go back to Java applets, which were going to change the world animated floating heads.
It's fun to go back to those initial examples.
Remember totally, dude. Aggressively terrible graphics. And in all seriousness, Macromedia Shockwave and Adobe Flash played key roles and continue to play key roles in the web ecosystem, and other plugins like Google Gears are all really, really important. And so we thought at Palm it was important to provide a similar mechanism to browser plugins. And we decided, you know, the same plugin model that browsers have used makes sense for our platform too. And so that's what the PDK is all about. It provides a plugin mechanism so that our web platform can be extended by developers to do all kinds of interesting things. And we anticipate that these plugins will also be shared by developers, and that there'll be a marketplace for developers to share the extensions they make to our web platform. And geez, we think that's pretty cool.
I think it's really important because, again, I was at Google before they had their own browser, so they couldn't just kind of push things themselves. And you get this really, you know, real feeling when you're a web developer that's like, okay, I could wait for browsers to come along and do stuff, but I really want to kind of push forward. And plugins is a way that gives you that ability, right? You can go in and just extend things and do things that you want, put them in the platform, and then again, you can share it with other developers, make it better, and then hopefully, just like the web always has done, it will then come along and standardize and come up with something that can be shared.
And it's even more exciting to me because what has kept plugins back is the fact that if you create a great plugin, you've got to figure out how to deploy it to all these different browsers. Yeah. But on our platform, a web OS application can include the plugin, and so you don't have the distribution problem that's hampered the effectiveness of plugins in the traditional web. Yeah. So we think this is going to be a really effective mechanism for developers. You know, there's also another important use for the PDK, and that's for developers who have C++ code bases to bring their applications to our platform without having to recode them from scratch.
Yeah.
You know, we love the web. We think it makes sense for solving device fragmentation, as we mentioned earlier, but if you've got an existing app, we don't want to tell you that you have to recode that from scratch just to bring it over because we happen to have chosen web technologies. In fact, if we had a magic wand we could use to support any existing code base and bring it to our platform, we probably would. And so we're really excited with the PDK to provide this on-ramp to people who have created games and other content for other mobile platforms that use C-based languages to bring those applications to our platform. And we've seen companies like EA and Gameloft and Glue do that in recent months. They've been early partners with us with our PDK. They had access to a pre-alpha version of the PDK to help us evolve the technology. And games like Need for Speed and others really showcase the power of the PDK, and they've been able to port these titles with a minimal amount of effort, and in some cases, in just days.
Yeah, because they're sharing the same underlying technology, right?
That's
OpenGL,
OpenGLES 1.1 and 2.0, the SDL library, and it, from a business perspective, it gives developers the opportunity to, with a minimum amount of effort, expand their market surface area. They can now sell it to a bunch of additional customers that they couldn't address in other marketplaces. So it's
right.
Pretty cool.
Exactly, and so you can put it into our catalog, and our catalog now, there's the official Palm catalog that's already on the device, and there's like 1,700 apps in there as of
over 1,700 as of like last week, I think.
Right, yeah. So there's a bunch of apps in there, but it's obviously a lot smaller than some of the other marketplaces, and that turns out to be really good for a developer. So these guys can come in, put their applications, they're very easily discoverable because they don't have some of the problems that some of the other platforms have, and they're actually making decent money. We've also found that, for whatever reason, people that buy our devices really are willing and capable of paying for applications, and so they're actually doing really well out of it.
One developer we talked to told us that with just a month in our marketplace and a small subset of their titles, they made more money in just that 1 month than they had in over a year in another marketplace with all their titles combined in that other marketplace. And that was really kind of cool.
Yeah, we'll have to get that one on the record so we can
go into the specifics.
Yeah, totally.
So, yeah.
Yeah. But there's also a couple of other differences in our catalog and the way we actually distribute applications.
Yeah, that's true.
So we've been talking about the Palm catalog that comes on the device, but we also wanted to kind of free developers to do more. The Palm catalog is very traditional catalog. You come in, you sign up with us, you deliver an application, we then review it, and then it can get through into the catalog. And that's meant to be like a great quality place for consumers to go to get their applications. That's great, but what if you want to not go through Palm for review and the like? So we have a thing that we call web distribution, where you deliver your application to us, and it goes right through. You get a URL back almost immediately, and then with that URL, you can merchandise it any way you want. You can tweet about it, blog about it, put it up in a list of various other sites that are out there that kind of show the apps that are going on. And you get to merchandise it, but the user gets the same great experience for installing an app. So when you go through and install an app, it all happens over the air. So pretty much everything on webOS devices happen over the air. You don't have to like plug into anything at any time. And so you put in your phone number, you get a message sent directly to your device. It's like, you want to install this app? Bing, it downloads and installs it. So this through web distribution can happen totally separately, no review, and bypass the actual catalog if you don't want to use the catalog. And you can also do both.
One distinction about our catalog that is interesting is that we actually charge a fee for applications to get into our catalog. We charge a $50 application submission fee. And at first you might wonder why we do this. It's certainly not about generating a profit.
No.
What we found as we looked at application marketplaces is that some of these marketplaces get massive to the point where it's really difficult for users to discover applications in the catalog, and it's difficult for developers to stand out. And we kind of wondered how we could control that dynamic a bit so that the catalog always had a really quality selection of applications. And so this $50 fee is intended to be a rate limiter, sort of a gate, sort of a minimum bar, I guess, for applications to go through. So that, in other words, if you as a developer don't think it's worth $50 for your application to be in our Palm catalog, then our users probably don't want to see that application. And other developers probably don't want that application competing for shelf space in that catalog. But as Dion mentioned, we've got this other model, this web distribution model, that isn't reviewed by Palm and that gives you complete freedom on merchandising, and that's completely free. You can always submit an application there without any fees at all. And in fact, we also have an open source developer program that lets you submit applications for free if they're open source to either the Palm catalog or the web distribution model.
Yeah, and we thought that was really important because we've got strong open source backgrounds. A lot of people in the company, you know, really believe in open source. A lot of our platform, Linux, WebKit, V8, kind of lives off of open source. So we wanted to reward people that want to kind of deliver to the commons their code. And so I think it's really important we did that. Another really interesting thing that we've done, I think, with the distribution plan is we open up all of the data into raw feeds. So anything in both the web and the Palm catalog itself, all of that data goes out in a feed that's totally public and open. And it's just a RSS 2.0 format with little extensions to give information that makes sense in an app catalog. And that's available for anyone to consume. And so a bunch of people have already done that. They've built their own kind of merchandising sites, and other people are getting statistics and doing different things on that. And it's really important to us to kind of open up what's going on, kind of you know, pull up the robe so people can see really what's happening, and then they can do interesting things with
rope.
Their data. Pull up the robes, yeah. Emperor's clothes, something, I don't know.
Okay.
And we think that's pretty cool too. And in fact, some interesting stuff has come out of that.
Yeah, so Nicholas Felton did some interesting visualizations of the data, just as one example of what you can do with it. And you're seeing some of these charts now. And this is really exciting. Felton did some visualizations for the New York Times, and he's done it for a bunch of other high-profile magazines too. And he actually does these interesting visualizations of his life each year. Like he shows you like how many pieces of sushi he's eaten and where his favorite one was. And all, it's really, so he's a great infographics guy. But this is the kind of stuff we wanted to facilitate with the feeds for people to sort of see exactly what's happening in the ecosystem. And we also worked on another really fun project, at least for us, called Project Appetite, based on these feeds.
Yeah, totally. So we've got these feeds, and we're like, how would we test them? We would actually build something that consumes them. And so in a couple of days, actually, Ben and I, you know, we wanted to get our coding chops in gear again.
And so We still have them.
Yes, indeed. So we built this thing called Project Appetite, which you can go to projectappetite.com. And we consume our feeds and built a little merchandising experience. And we had a bunch of fun with it while we were doing this. And so obviously we did this to kind of test the feeds and give you different layout, but there's a few little Easter eggs. Isn't there an Easter egg in there somewhere?
Yeah, so there are a few. One of them is that if you hit Control F, you enter into fancy mode. And when you click on more info, if you're on Safari latest on, I think, Snow Leopard, you see like the actual cards that you see here in the screen flip in a 3D effect to sort of show what CSS transforms, hardware accelerated CSS transforms are capable of. And that's one of the effects that we wanted to put in there.
Yeah, and you'll see that like when you do searching, it's really, really quick because a lot of that is actually client side, which is kind of an interesting thing. We had a couple of days to work this together. And so we split up the server from the client and built out a mock layer so we could go off and do the front end while someone's working on the back end consuming the feeds. And what was kind of fun was there's another site called api.projectapidai.com that uses the new Node.js, CommonJS, you know, super cool event server that's kind of NIO-like from the Java world. And what's really cool about it is we're able to take Node and then just kind of take this mock layer that was a full client-side view of the world and just start using it. So we could just kind of wrap together, do a minimal mapping between URLs and the actual client-side code that did all the searching and stuff, and suddenly we had a server. So it's kind of fun to play with a bunch of new technology and kind of see how this stuff works. And again, all of this stuff is open source. You can grab it from our GitHub repository. So we have on github.com/palm a bunch of open source stuff that we've released up there, and we'll be putting a lot more up there so the community can kind of fork it and do fun things with it. Mm.
So that's Project Appetite. We're also really excited about something called Project Ares. Project Ares was developed by our tools team, and it is a web-based IDE for developing WebOS applications. And it really is kind of amazing when you sit back and look at the tool, what's possible on the web, because this gives you a rich UI editor where you can drag and drop the UI for Palm applications. And it also gives you the ability to edit the code in the browser with a quality code editing tool called Bespin that Dion and I had a hand in over at Mozilla, and Ares integrates that. And so all through the browser, it turns out you can create the UI, edit the code, and actually deploy the application to either an emulator or an actual Palm application, a Palm device. This sort of demonstrates a couple of things for us. First, it demonstrates the power and vision of being able to do this all in a web browser. And in the future, we want to take this even further, where you can collaborate with other people through the browser and have all your projects just in the cloud, so you can go to any workstation and get your project. And we think that's actually going to be a really compelling way to develop software in the future. So check out Project Ares. And in a subsequent video podcast, we're going to go in depth on Ares and do a walkthrough and show you more about how this tool works.
Yeah, it was fun. I had someone in my family that just was like, you know, follows my Twitter, Facebook stream and has no idea what anything is, and started to see this Project Ares thing and played around and kind of like built out a UI, even though they can't program or anything. It's really, really easy to use, fun to do layouts and all that kind of stuff.
Fun.
Yeah. So we've got interesting ways to build apps. Hopefully we've excited you about the fact that, you know, mobile web is going to be the future of building apps. What can we do to actually get you building apps right now? We've got over 1,700 apps in the catalog. Some really cool stuff coming. We've got the PDK for getting into that world. But it's really fun to build web apps right now. And to kind of juice the economy a little bit here, we just put out a program called Hot Apps.
So the Hot Apps promotion is kind of this crazy idea that we came up with to take $1 million.
$1 million.
And juice the application ecosystem and give developers a greater return on their investment. And we didn't want to do a contest. We didn't want to do like some, you know, application idol thing.
Yeah, where someone has to be the Simon character and say that's crap.
And they just sort of arbitrarily choose like, that's the best one. And everyone was like, what the heck? You know, mine was pretty good. And so we decided, let's just let the marketplace decide based on downloads. So we're taking this $1 million, and the applications that receive the most downloads during a fixed period of time, from February 1st to May 31st, will receive this money. And we didn't want to put the money in the hands of a small number of developers. We didn't want there to be 20 winners or even just 100 winners. There's actually going to be over 400 winners. And the way we did it is we split the app ecosystem into two categories, paid and free. And applications that are both paid and free will receive the same payouts. The top downloaded free application and the top downloaded paid application will each receive $100,000. And then the next tier are going to be 20 developers each. So 20 paid developers and 20 free developers will receive additional $10,000 payouts. And then 200 free application developers and 200 paid application developers, the next ones in terms of popularity, will receive $1,000 cash payouts. And so we're really excited about this. And one other aspect that really excites us also is the fact that free application developers now have a financial incentive, which is something they hadn't had before.
Yeah, it's going to be fun really to kind of surprise some of these guys.
And yeah, exactly.
You were being nice and you just put your app out there totally for free and here's a big prize.
Yep, totally.
So it's pretty cool. And then we've been working with a bunch of carriers. We were just out in France, in Paris last week, and SFR, who we announced we're going to be launching with shortly there in Europe, hosted us at their kind of main mobile phone shop, which is kind of a flagship store.
It was amazing, with like a disco ball.
Yeah, and felt like I was in the Moulin Rouge.
I wish we could show pictures of the bathroom, but that's another story entirely.
Totally. It was just this super cool place for a mobile phone store. And we talked to a bunch of developers there, and with SFR, they actually launched a French-specific actual contest where if you're in indie and up to, I think, three people in a coding group can kind of win for building really great apps that are in French and localized and all that kind of good stuff. So also look out for how we're working with carriers in different locales and see how you can get plugged in and get even more juice.
That's right. One other thing about hot apps that we should mention, PDK applications are not included in the contest. It's just for web applications. And we did that because the PDK isn't yet fully available to our community, and so we didn't want to give the early adopters that we've been working with an advantage. We wanted to have the playing field be fairly level. And so in the future, we may have a PDK promotion, who knows? But right now, Hot Apps is just about web applications.
So great. So hopefully we've whet your appetite a little bit to build some apps. In future episodes, we're going to do really fun walkthroughs of these apps. We've been building some interesting apps ourselves recently. But right now, if you want to get going, you can go to developer.palm.com. It's got tutorials and reference material and all that kind of good stuff. So you can learn how to download the SDK and get building right away. Again, if you're a web developer, a lot of this will be very familiar. And we can't wait to see what kind of applications you build.
And so we'd love to hear from you. Send us an email anytime to devrel@palm.com. That's the address you see on your screen right now. And we'd love to work with you in the future. So let us know any feedback you have. Let us know what changes you want to see to the dev program and to the platform in general. Listen, we're super excited about the future of the web. And we're really proud to be working for a company that's embraced the web platform and made it the native platform for our devices. And we can't wait to be speaking with you on future versions of this podcast, future episodes of the podcast. So thanks for listening to this one, and we'll see you later.